what Satan hears in the last church before you, we know nothing of it, but we want to know that for you. Speak to us, Father, in the language we shall all understand. And the grace to be the doer of the word. We don't want to hear for hearing's sake, but the enabling grace to be the doer, Father, we pray that we will meet upon us together. That at the end of the lesson, O God, our life shall be better, and our life shall be transformed, our life shall move forward, and our people around us shall see the glory and the power of God in our lives. We thank you so much because we are faithful. Holy Spirit, take it over from us, teach us your word, and help us to pray with you. From Jesus' precious name, we have prayed.
Amen.
So I want to welcome each and every one of us into God's presence. We are here for our welcome school, welcome Sunday school. We are taking lesson 8 today. Lesson 8. And the general topic says, clad yourself with God's armor. Clad yourself with God's armor. You know what armor is? Your weapon of warfare, your weapon, equipment, equip yourself with when you are preparing for battle, the ammunition, what other name for armor that you can use? Yes. Weapon, ammunition, what? Sorry? Asset. That is we use for fighting battle war. When you are going, you want to go and fight, you don't just go with a spoon and plate. You know, and if someone is going to be battlefront with that, you know, then that plate has prepared to fail or to be defeated. But when we go to battlefront for army, they go with gun, it has a lot of bullets, they go with bomb, they go with so many things. As they cover themselves to protect themselves, they wear helmets, they put their breastplates, they wear strong shoes that can resist bullets, they cover themselves and they also have weapons to fight back. So those are the weapons we are talking about. Those are physical ones, but we are talking about the spiritual weapon that we use to either fight or to protect ourselves. So the general topic says clad yourself. Another word for clad is clothe. Clothe yourself or you cover yourself. Clothe, cover yourself with God's armor. Protect yourself with God's armor, not human armor, because there are some man-made armor, but God's armor. Why is it God's armor? Because we are fighting spiritual battle, and God that we are talking about, He knows everything about the enemy we are fighting, which is the devil. We don't know much about the enemy. We have never seen him before, and he has been living before we were created. He was in heaven, so he knows everything about this world. But the God that we have is before him. He existed before you. He created him. So he knows his strength. God knows the devil's strength. He knows his power. He knows his strategy. Through that, God now formulates all these weapons. Because God knows that if we use this weapon, we'll be able to defeat him. By our own power, we can't fight the devil. The devil will beat us down. We defeat us even before the battle starts. But because we have a God that is stronger than the devil, he now formulated all this weapon for us to use, that we should not use our human strength or our human weapon. So by the time we use this weapon, we are sure that we shall defeat the devil. So that's why God gave us all this weapon to use. So today we'll be looking at all this weapon. We've looked at some of them last week, offensive weapon, how we can, you know, we can attack the devil with weapons that God has provided for us. We are going from there today to see more weapons that we can use while fighting spiritual battle. And then the topic for adults says, prepare to remain victorious in battle. It's a preparation. It's not something you just wake up and say, I'm strong enough to fight every battle of life. No, it's a preparation. You know, at times God will prepare us in a way of throwing us to unnecessary battle. No, maybe in 2 or 3 years' time, God knows that there is going to be a serious war against one's life. And today we not bring someone, the devil just enter someone to be treating you badly, that will push you to prayer. Or something, maybe demon sickness will just come from nowhere to attack you. And you are just praying, God, I need healing. While you are praying, you are preparing, you are becoming strong, just stronger day by day. And when you feel battle will not come, because you have gone through some small things that really built you, you say, this one, just like the other one, I will fight and I will also win. With all the weapons I've been able to acquire here, the blood of Jesus, the name, all those things you'll be using that will be very effective in life. But if you are not prepared, everything that happens, you run to one pastor to help you, you run to one sister to help you, you run to that person to assist or to look for help elsewhere, even outside God. When the river to become such will be helpless. So whatever little challenges we are facing in life is to build us and to prepare us for the battle whenever it will show up. So is it, we need preparation if we truly want to remain victorious in the battle of life. And the topic for our youth is that don't end up being a loser. Someone says, if you don't prepare, you are preparing to. If you don't prepare to, that's all that
you have to say.
Okay, yes. Thank you. If you fail to prepare, you are preparing to fail. If you don't want to be a loser, you must not be. Preparation. So if you don't want to fail, you need to prepare. For youth, don't end up being a loser. A loser is someone that is defeated. A loser is someone that failed, that didn't get to the goal, that missed the mark. For intermediate, God wants you to win. It's the heart desire of our Father, our God, to always win every battle of life. We will not know how God will be glad and happy if he sees us overcoming, coming out victorious every day. He will be so happy. Not anything we need to do to push us down today. We are on the floor, we are crying, oh God, have mercy again. But anytime you are able to stand up against the challenge of the devil, maybe it's temptation, maybe it's sickness, maybe it's a financial challenge, and you are able to resist the devil and overpower the devil, we are giving God joy, happiness. That, yes, that's my daughter, that's my son. I know, like he was doing to Job, and Job did not disappoint me. So God also is counting on us like that. And our memory verse is from Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, from verse 11 to 12. Ephesians chapter 6, from verse 11 to 12. It reads, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, and against the rulers of the darkness of this age, and against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. So it's giving us that we should put on, we should wear all the armor of God. A whole, it's like a base, it's like they are together. A whole of it, not one living one. The whole of it, you should put it on so that we're able to fight all the spiritual battle that will come on our way. As we all know, when it's not everyone that goes to the battle that's always victorious. Praise God. Some will go, they will win and come back victorious. Some will go, they will be defeated. The last battle of Jonathan and their son, they were killed. They went, but they never came back. David went to so many battles and he came back without being destroyed. Some went, but they came back with affliction. They are badly wounded. So there are different ways we go. It depends on our preparation, how we take seriously, how we master the weapon we are using, how to go, where to use gun. I'm talking about the physical freedom now, physical battle. Where to use gun, where to use tear gas, where to use, you know, there are different ways you are supposed to use gun. You don't use tear gas, you go to go war. So I pray God will help us together to know where to use which weapon as we go on in our spiritual battle. So the aim of today's lesson is to motivate and encourage the Christian to identify and put on the whole armor of God. To put the whole armor of God on. Because God has provided it for us, it's for our good. So we're going to the lesson because today we want to see those weapons. We started last week, we talked about the offensive one. Today we're talking about the part that talked about the defensive part. So we are going to the first part that says the whole armor of God. Ephesians chapter 6, that's our memory verse. Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 11 to 13. Ephesians chapter 6. From verse 11 to 13. But put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Having done all, to stand. He's telling us we should put all this weapon on, because the enemy we are fighting is stronger than us, is more intelligent, and we don't have the power to fight him. The only thing we can fight him with is the weapon that God has provided for us. Because God, his heart desire is for us to win all the battles that may ever come on our way. So that's why God designed and prescribed all these weapons for us. They are not man-made, they are not physical weapons, but they are spiritual. Because in the battle that we are fighting, physical weapons, they are useless. They are very, very useless. You say you want to fight the devil with a gun. Where do you see him to shoot him? There's only thing that you can see him. So God knows what weapon and what armor are effective against the array of spiritual enemies we have. So we need to carefully examine the weapon and the armor, and we should learn how to diligently put them on. There's one thing to know them, another thing is to put them on and use them. We need to put them on and use them so that we will not be a casualty in the welfare of life. And there's an example we are given in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17. David and Goliath. We saw David, before he fought Goliath, actually he has killed a lion and a bear. So he has proved this weapon and he has found out they are very effective. If he had not killed lion and bear, he would not have that boldness to kill, to say, I will bring down the head of Goliath. Because he has gone through some challenges with, okay, I saw a lion and a bear, they picked a sheep, and I went after them, I killed them, I rescued the sheep from their mouths with my hand. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them. You know, he has tried, he has used them. So he knew that time that this power, this weapon cannot fail me. Some people try to put on him what he has not tried. I can't do it. Even if we see the way they describe Saul, very tall, with a very big chest, with a breastplate of iron, his shoe, everything is brass and iron, even his sword, everything. Well prepared. The weapon of Goliath, he was prepared. And Saul would say, hey, this boy, I don't want you to die. Use my own weapon. Because I know this Goliath has been a warrior from his youth. So let me help you. Let me give you something that can help you in life. Like many of us who do. You say this spiritual weapon that we can go see. Let me go and help myself somewhere. And let me ask for help from somewhere so that they can help me and do this thing and have this thing. But because David knew the God he was serving, he volunteered to go and fight Goliath because he knew the God he was serving. He knew that God, and the weapon that he's going to use can never fail him. That's why we need to develop interest in knowing all this weapon and putting them on and make sure we try them. If you don't try them, you will not know that they are working. How will you know that the blood of Jesus can heal someone when you are sick? That name. How will you know that the name of Jesus can deliver someone from trouble if you have not found yourself in trouble and call that name until you see results? How will you know there is power in the word of God when there's a problem? We don't mention the word, we don't release it, we don't bring it forth into such situation until we begin to see changes. Until we try them, we will not know that they are working. If the devil will not find out that we don't know this weapon, we will just make our life a playground because we know that we are ignorant. But if we know that this person knows that there is power in the name of Jesus, there is power in the blood of Jesus, the word of God is powerful, and he knows, he will run away. If at all we come, he will just say, let me try, maybe this is sleeping at this time. If we try, but if we say, this one is still on fire, we'll run back. So, David was able to defeat Goliath because he all the weapon God has provided for, he was using them. Even while he was a shepherd in the field, and was able to destroy Goliath with the weapon. He was able, you know, if God should give us a weapon to use and we refuse to use it, then whatever happened to us, it's not God's fault. You remember when the children of Israel, they were in Egypt, and the angel of destruction was to pass through the nation that night. God told the people of Israel, put the blood of the lamb on your lintel and its doorpost. So for as many that will disobey that, they will not use the blood of the lamb. What will happen to them? They will be destroyed with the Egyptian. Is that God's fault? No. The same way God has provided all this weapon for us, we are the ones to make use of them so that we can come out victorious. Not using them, it means we are prepared to be defeated. But that is not the plan of God for our life. That is not the plan of God for our life. The devil, however, is much older than any human being and more intelligent. Human wisdom cannot match Satan's own. Other people believe they can bargain with the devil to win sympathy or possession. Unfortunately, the devil is very wicked and therefore cannot be appeased. He cannot appease him. In their dictionary, there's nothing like mercy. You will go to God and say, God, have mercy on me. I've done this, please, God. God is a merciful God. He will have mercy. But the devil, in their dictionary, there's nothing like mercy. Even if you are right, it's when you are doing what is right that annoys him a lot. So, the devil has no mercy. He has no good gift. I was talking to someone like this pastor, okay, with my new boss. We were talking about the devil has no good gifts. If the devil should give you a cap, that what you call a cape, if he should give you, he will remove your head. Where will you put the cape? If he gives you a shoe, remove the leg. Where would you wear the shoe? That's the devil for you. So you can't beg him. You can't say please. The only language he hears is force attacking, resisting. That's only what he can hear, and he will run away. Like Jesus resisted in the word of God. So I pray God will help us to go, you know, to all this weapon that we are talking about, and to come out with them prepared to fight with them, so that anytime the devil will show up, we'll be able to pull him down, be able to destroy his plan. We cannot stop him from fighting, but we can stop him from defeating us. We can stop him from defeating us. So that is the first part, telling us how effective the weapons are that God has given to us, the reason why we need to put on those weapons, because the devil is smarter than us, but God being our backup, we are smarter than him. When God is holding our hand, we are stronger than him. But when we are alone without God, he said, I want to deal with the devil myself in my own way, with my own calculation. I pity those people that play the game with God. They will do like this. As if God cannot see them. God will say this, they will do otherwise. And they've forgotten that the devil is just looking for a hole, just a small space, a gap to enter and destroy lives. If you give the devil a steering, he will take over. If you give the devil a lift, he will take over the steering. Give him an inch, he will take you a mile. Tell the devil for you. You don't just play with him, you don't just give him a chance for anything. So, God is a faithful God, is a loving God. He has designed those weapons for us. All we need to do is to put them on, to clothe ourselves, to protect ourselves with it every time. Every time. So, part two says armor for defense. Last week we talked about offensive weapons. We talked about offensive weapons and how we can make them effective. Today we are looking at armor for defense. Defense is to protect ourselves. What we put on while on the battlefront, when the devil is shooting his arrow, destroying so many things, then if he's even coming towards us, there are protective weapons from us that will make those things to fall back and to not enter into our lives. So those are the defensive weapon we want to talk about today. Is in the book of Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 6. We start from verse 14 to 17. Ephesians 6, 14 to 17. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit. We have so many weapons there, and we have them listed in our manual. We have them listed in our manual. The components of spiritual armor are listed in our manual. We have them. But if you notice something, you will discover all these things, they are for front. They are weapons we can put on in front, that can cover us, our front, which means we have the Lord Jesus Christ as our captain, as our commander. All we need to do is go in front, we need to follow. No matter how tough we battle, we just need to follow. No matter how difficult the situation may be, the challenges may be, we just need to follow. Because turning our back on him, on our commander that is going, we have nothing protecting us from the back. There's no weapon covering our back. Our back is empty. It's open. If you say, Jesus, this is baptism, I want to go back. Anything can happen. Anything can, because there, nothing is protecting the back. So provision was not made for those that return their back on Jesus. Provision has been made for those who will follow Jesus. I want us to read Revelation chapter 12 to really know why the devil is fighting believers like this. Though it has been prophesied in the book of Genesis chapter 3 verse 15 that the devil will always be after the seed of the woman. But in Revelation chapter 12 verse 17, are we up there? Yes. It reads, and the dragon, which is the devil, was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So if you're a child of God, you are a believer, you say now, yeah, I have given my life to Jesus, everything should be bread and butter, bed of roses, no problem. You are lying. You see, because he's after those that are keeping the commandment of God and those that have the testimony of Jesus Christ. But those that are not doing that, those that are disobeying the word and the commandment of God, you know that those who are in this cage already, the devil wants to take over the whole world. He wants to be the ruler of this age. So those of us that have seen the light of Jesus, that have gone to and that have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, it's after us. That's why it's fine. You say, why is my life like this? Yes, because the devil is after you. But when you have all this problem, the devil himself will know that you are going. Your life is not a playground. Your life is not a place where you can do all the stuff. And whatever any challenge is throwing is for us to build ourselves. It's not the time to say, I want to go back. Ah, this job and job is too much for me. Financially, I'm struggling. This one will say, my health is, you have challenge. Some people say, I'm married for 10 years, no issue. Some people will say, spiritually, I'm just down. I'm just like this. Temptation here and there. Yes. We need to be strong in the Lord. We need to put on all this weapon and fight on. When you win one battle, that's not saying, yes, I'm the winner. No, it's fun. If you win one battle, tomorrow is really a bigger one. Praise God. Yeah. You're not saying that because I've won this one, I'm a champion. We are not champions until we lay our sword at the feet of Christ on the last day. When we are breathing the last breath, I say, wow, what a battle, what a life, what a victorious life. And we just breathe. As we go to your eyes there, you open it at the feet of Christ and say, here I come. Until then, we are not supposed to give up at all. Don't say, I'm tired. No. Let's keep on fighting. We shall keep on fighting. So let's go through those components that we are given. Number one is garden of faith, or belt of faith. So you see, when you see our men, when you wear their trousers, they use belt to hold what they have worn. Maybe if you put their shirt in, you know. This belt is to hold all the weapon that we put on, the breastplate, weapon that will be there, the sword that you put inside the belt to be able to hold them. What that means is sincerity. Sincerity. Truth. Sincerity. This is the guard round the waist of Jesus. God demands truth in the inward part. In our inward part, God desires truth. He demands from us truth. Lying or insincerity is the hallmark of the devil. When you are lying, when you are not sincere, you are giving the devil a gap for him to come into your life. God is God. He's not a liar. You see, many believers, they don't see life as anything bad. They don't see it as for the devil is taking advantage of that to mess up their lives. Then you could go to the endeavor of categorizing it: white lie, blue lie, red lie. Lamb is lie, and the Bible says all liars shall find their portion in the lake of fire. So, people of God, if when we allow lies in our life, we are giving room for the devil to affect our lives. And one thing I've noticed is, if you lie, you will use 1,000 lies to cover that one lie you have told someone. If Brother Oshie should come to me and say, ah, where were you yesterday? I was at work. I say, ah, I went to see a friend. Oh, a friend. Really? Okay. So what is the name of the friend? I will tell you another one. What time? Another time. Few days later, if any time I see Brother Oshie, I will be calculating in order to protect that lie I've told before, so that the thing will not contradict. What struggle? Why would I be going through all this? If you are okay, that time I was in the office, you know I will not think about that. What I've told him again, because what I've said is true. Because I don't need to defend it, because it is true. You don't need to defend truth. If it's true, it's true. In heaven, on earth, it is true. But if it's a lie, you need to protect it so that it will not leak, it will not bounce back on you. You will be doing some funny things. And doing that, God is stepping away from us. We are rendering this guard of truth useless and enemies coming to attack. When we say the truth, when we are sincere, then we are calling on God to help us. It's a weapon. When you live by the truth, Satan will not be able to trap you. The devil will even put any trap anywhere. You will not fall into it because you always say the truth. That's one thing I always tell my children. Say the truth and then the devil will shame. When will you cover up things? Who broke the plate? Only I did. I can say, okay, why are you not so careful? Why? And it will finish there. Then who broke it? I don't know. Who broke it? I don't know. So I don't know who broke the plate. You know? You put so many things in, you know, and the devil will say, yes, this and not me. They are not together. The person knows that they are the one that broke it, but is not ready to say the truth. If we ever will find ourselves, let people know you that you are a woman that always say what is right, or a man that always say the truth. At your workplace, when they write time, they say you come by 10 and they are writing 8. But let them know that your own is too much. The mother of Jesus or the auntie of Jesus. You always say the truth, you always, even on paper. How will you lie before paper? Paper that cannot buy it, you still lie in front of paper. Nobody is there, no cleaning behind you. You are still lying on the paper. But when we talk to ourselves, I want to be true. I want to be sincere. In any relationship, you know, many ladies, they find themselves waiting unnecessarily because they are not true. They are not sincere. If a man with a child of God come in a relationship with you, today we tell one time, the man will find out that that's the next, I'm sorry, I will not speak that. The following time, you find it to be telling lies. Which man will want to go into a relationship with a woman that is not straightforward? Or a woman that is a child of God, I want to go into a relationship with a man that is not straightforward, that is not sincere to even himself, more or less the woman that he or she wants to marry. What's that person that is not sincere does not know that that is the trap of the devil. And if you fall into that trap of insincerity, you mess up your own life. In the workplace, they see that this is not, you know, a serious person. In a relationship, they say that to me. There are so many women that will, their husband will say, if I know she's like this, I won't have married her. And the husband will say, if I know this man is like this. Because of insincerity, your yes will not be yes, your no will not be no. The devil will capitalize on that to be trapping you. Yeah? If the devil knows that this person is a professional liar, you will just be making people to ask you questions. Before we know, you will tell this thing and we will be from one temptation to the other. But one day you say, I need this weapon. I want to be sincere. To my brothers and sisters in church, you know, so many things happen that when we ask, what really happened? Have truth. I've met someone that said, I'm having issues, and this problem. I said, okay, what is it? Can you brief me? Can you tell me the situation? And the way the person was talking, the Spirit of God is telling me that that's half truth. The real thing has not been told. How do you know God to help when you are not ready to say the truth? Balance of truth, sincerity with God. On the altar of God, be sincere with the people of God, be sincere with the servant of God, be sincere. If this is the problem, say it the way it is not. He said, because it's not one of us who will keep him away from knowing some truth. But God knows, and he's a revealer of truth. One day, all the truth will be exposed. All the truth will be exposed. That's God. Yes, be sincere. It's a weapon. When we are fighting, oh God, do this for us this year. But we are not sincere to ourselves. We are not sincere to the people around us. In our family, we are not sincere to one another. And we won't want to know. When this woman is lacking, the devil will take advantage of that to fight. To fight. We thank God today is a class. It's not a judgment. We can just say that how come for so years I've not been true to you. Please forgive me. As for today, I will be sincere to you. I will be true to you. And do it consciously. Let them shout at you. I don't care. Let them shout at you. If I make a mistake, I will tell you I have made a mistake. Instead of hashing things up, you say, I made a mistake. You see, why they are not victims? I don't know. It just happened. I'm sorry. So if you want me to pay for it, I pay for it. And I have a clear conscience wherever I go. Than to hide it anytime I see, maybe I have seen that mistake. Let's live a free life. Let's save ourselves from all those struggles and be true to ourselves, be true to the people around us, be true to the people of God, and that is your command, blessing of God. And keep the devil away, because the devil knows in that area, he cannot trap you. He cannot trap us. We don't necessarily. I pray God will hear this, because that is very, very important in the house of God. The next one is breastplate of righteousness. A life of righteousness clears the Christian of every accusation Satan may bring against him. The devil is an accuser of brethren. You know, remember the Joshua, the high priest, that was putting on dirty clothes, and the devil was accusing him before the angels of God. And God came to his rescue. So we need to live our holy life. Jesus imputes his righteousness to us and expects we keep the white garment of righteousness. He clothes us with, we should keep that garment of righteousness, he clothes us with, to be kept unsoiled, since we are justified by this imputed righteousness. Satan is powerless in attacking us if we put on the garment of righteousness that Jesus has handed over to us. Garment of righteousness. That's the breastplate. We talked about the belt to hold all the armor together. The belt is very important, because if you have the breastplate of righteousness without the belt of truth, it will fall off. You hold the breastplate of righteousness with, you know, the belt to hold it. So all of them are important. Breastplate of righteousness. How righteous are we? How old? There are these common things. Nobody is righteous. Nobody is righteous. Nobody is righteous. That's why it's in there. Romans chapter 3, verse 10. That nobody is righteous. Not even one. And we quote it as nobody is righteous. And continue to live in sin. And then we say, carry on. And then we to waste the life of such people. What happened? to the death of Jesus on the cross? What happened to anybody's righteous? What happened to his death? What happened to his own righteousness that he has given to us? He took our place. He became sinner that we may be righteous. On our own, we are not righteous. It was confirmed in the book of Isaiah chapter 64 verse 6 that our righteousness is like a filthy rag. We are not righteous. But in as much as we are giving our life, we say this is our life, we are giving to Jesus. The life we live is not ours. According to Galatians chapter 2 verse 20, the life we live, we have been crucified with Christ. We no longer live. The life we live in Christ that gave his life for us. So if we are living the life of Christ, we are no more sinners. Because Jesus is not a sinner. So we should walk in that consciousness that I'm a sinner. I can't live in righteousness. But because I have Jesus and I'm following his path, I'm following his word, I will. Because if you to confess you are a righteous person, you are a holy person, you will be holy. God cannot say we should do what is not possible. It may be hard. Because people see people stealing. In the office, they are using, you know, putting zero at the back of 1,000 to become 10,000. And you are looking, and you may be the one paying the money out. Because no evidence to put that is incorrect. And just, and you are saying, it may be hard, but it's possible. And God is a rewarder. Just keep on being faithful. Keep on being righteous. And then God from God. We clear of all those things that we thought we have God. Just one day reward. Just one day reward with God. It's better than all these calculations people are doing. Just keep on living a holy life. Because when we put on this breastplate of righteousness, the white garment of righteousness that Jesus has imputed upon us at salvation, when we hold on to it, the devil cannot mess up with us. He will try. May not try, but he can never overpower us. Because we, in the book of John chapter 14 verse 30, was written that the enemy, the devil came into me and found nothing against me. That's Jesus' life. He will try to see if he can see any accusation against Jesus Christ. But he looked at the life of Jesus, he tried something before, he found nothing against Jesus Christ. So, I'm not sure that the enemy will come and say, in what way can we pin him down or pin her down? Financial aspect, she's a title. And in this area, she's doing what is right. There she is. You know, the devil will always look for one thing or the other by wondering that. That's why we need to be conscious of everything we do. We need to, because this garment of righteousness that Jesus has imputed upon us, we need to keep it holy. We need to keep it holy. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 said, because we have given our life to Jesus, we are righteous. Let's keep this garment of righteousness Jesus has given us. Don't let us soil it with any sin. Sin is, will make us powerless and will make the devil to attack us. But when we keep the garment clean, the devil will become powerless to attack us. The next one is helmet of salvation. We put it on our head to protect us from the enemy. Helmet of salvation secures the head from attacks in form of wrong doctrine, defilement, wandering from the truth. Salvation assures the Christian of the hope of eternal life. Our mind is protected. The head carries the mind. It's protected from false doctrine, wrong doctrine, defilement, and wandering away from the truth. That's the mind. The helmet of salvation. Meaning we give our life to Jesus Christ, what does that do for us? We renew our mind. Give us a new beginning. How we see things to change. Those things we were running after before, they will become of no use. Say, and I'll be running after these things before. Or you may see that those things do not count in the realm of spiritual realm. They're just earthly things. People say, if I don't get this today, if I don't get that tomorrow, all those things may not be. Will be less important. to us because we have put on the helmet of salvation and we are secure, we are protected, and we have a hope of eternal life. Our mind will be renewed to be thinking of how to live to please God and how to live to meet the standard that God has prepared for us. The next one is shield of faith. Shield of faith. It's a shield like a right piece, a metal. When arrows come, you'll be able to do like this, to resist. That's faith. When we have faith, when we have strong faith, then we'll be able to protect ourselves from that. Faith in the finished work of Christ and in God's promises keeps the heart from being wounded by doubt, fear, worry, temptation to sin. When we have faith, we'll be able to protect us from that. When you study the Word of God and you are sure what the Word of God is telling you, you will not be able to, doubt will not come to you, fear will not come to you, worry, temptation, you'll be able to overcome because you have a strong faith. You have a strong faith. So we need to develop our faith life in the Word of God. When minister of God are preaching, and we already settle our mind about some issues in the Bible, we have already gotten our own interpretation and own understanding that we are not even ready to listen to whatever the Spirit of God is saying to us, even at any point in time, because our faith is very low. And if we hear the word, there's a place in the Bible that said they heard the word, but the word did not do anything in their life because it did not meet with faith in their lives. So when we have faith and the word of God comes, we receive the word of God with faith. We receive it with faith. That's why when it can bring forth fruit in our lives. Like the story, the parable of the sower, we have different ground on which the seed of the word can fall. Some on good ground, some among the thorns on the rock, on the wayside. But the one on the good ground will meet with faith for you to grow and germinate. And the last one there, sandal or boots for the preparation of the gospel of peace. When we begin to preach the gospel, when you have faith in the gospel, in the word of God, to be able to share it. So that as you are following the master, you will encourage other people to follow the master with you. And doing that, you have peace all around. It says, sandal boot of preparation of the gospel, that is boot of preparation of the gospel of peace, readiness to accept the gospel of Christ and to spread the gospel, enables Christians to follow their commander without hesitation and grants them peace all that. On every side we experience peace. Peace when we preach the gospel. But before we can preach, we must have faith in what we are preaching. If you don't have faith in what you are preaching, then even people will not even answer. You say, go and preach it to yourself. When you preach it to yourself, then when it's working in your life, we can see, we can stop and follow you. So faith is very important. All these weapons we have mentioned, they are very, very important to protect us. The elements of salvation to protect our mind. A lot of things, the battle actually always takes place in your mind. They are not in your mind. And if the mind is attacked, the battle is won. So we need to protect our mind. That's why the Bible says we should renew our mind. We should keep on renewing our mind. So the last part says weapon of offensive. We talked about that one last week. We talked about the offensive weapon, and we have two verses in our text. That's 17 and 18. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. I don't know, in my Bible, I underline in the Spirit. And washing death unto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Pray in the Spirit. So, our weapon of offense here, we have prayer and the word of God. Prayer, the word of God, and I want us to have to eat the blood of Jesus. mentioned last week, the blood of Jesus and the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Those are the weapons, though they fall into the category of defending, and you know, you can use it to defend yourself. When the enemy are attacking you, to protect yourself, use the blood of Jesus. You can use the name of Jesus, the word of God. You can use prayers. And if you want to attack the enemy, you want to fight back, you can also use the same word of God. So they have dual purpose or purposes. They have dual ways. Use them as offensive and use them as defensive weapon. We have four of them: the blood of Jesus, the name of Jesus, the word of God, and prayer. When we talk about the word of God, which is the spirit, sword of the spirit. For a child of God, we need to learn and feed from the Holy Spirit, the word of God. When we sit down, we read the word of God, we should read and meditate on them. Meditate. You know, there's a difference between reading and meditating. A man of God said he can read a verse 100 times. I asked myself, 100 times. And he does not read Bible sitting or standing. He read his Bible on his knee. How would those people not get revelation that they have not yet? On his knee, in prayers. Reading the Bible and praying, oh God, what is this verse up to? What does it mean? We are all Christians, we are going to the same heaven. But if you don't know all this well, the devil will be cheating us while some people are winning. Only still, read the Bible, you can read a verse 100 times to really know what this verse means. So, the word of God, we need to read it with all seriousness, because the word of God is alive, is strong and sharper than any two-edged sword. By effectively deploying the word, Jesus defeated Satan when he was tempted. It is written, but it is written, but before we can say it is written, it must settle in our hearts. We must know the efficacy of the word of God. That is powerful. It can do anything. It's a sword. When you say sword, you know, so when you are fighting, you do like this. It can cut anybody that wants to stand on the road. That is the word of God. Sword of the Spirit. You can use it as a sword, and when we release it on the enemy, it will land on them like a bullet to destroy our enemy. So whenever battle you are facing, find a relevant word. Whatever battle you are facing in life, just go to the word of God. If it is shy, if it's barrenness, you want God to bless you with fruit of the womb, go to the word of God and check those places where God promised our mothers in the Lord that God ahead of us. How where God promised them, you will not be barren. Say, no, no, the children shall be barren. Look for those of us, put them together. Begin to read them, begin to digest them, begin to meditate on them. One day, believe them, speak them, stand by it. One day to come alive to you, the power behind it will come alive. And when you speak it like you are the writer of the word. That's it. If it's healing, if it's a favor we are looking for, if it's job, promotion, just go to the word. See that. Bring out those verses that go with what you are expecting of you, and you see the future. That if it's overcoming one sin in your life, just look for those verses that will give you, that gives assurance of victory over sin. You will get it. Read it, meditate, speak it, memorize it, allow it to digest in your heart, and the victory, the power of that word will come alive. God gave the promise that his word will not come back to him without accomplishing what he has set it to do. That's the word of God. It's not for fun. It's to do something in my life. It's to do something in your life. So when we apply it with that faith that is needed, then we see results. Then we see results. And last week we talked a lot about prayer. Prayer is another one. We use it as an offensive weapon and a defensive weapon. As you know, the effective prayer of righteous is so powerful. It produces results. When you pray, consistently. Not pray today, tomorrow, next, don't pray, we pray every time. And prayer is hard work. That's why many people don't pray. Prayer is hard work, which many Christians are not ready to engage in. Many just mention their needs before God, but are not prepared to agonize at the altar of prayer. Many people are not ready to agonize at the altar of prayer. You have a situation that is staring at you, that is affecting your family, that is affecting your life, the life of your children, and say, God, you see. God, you see. God say, I can see now. Until you take it as a battle and say, no, God, I'm here. Please do something. And you are there on the altar of prayer. God help us. We need to be watchful to this end with all perseverance. We need to be watchful. We need to be serious. We need to pray on to receive results. The blood of Jesus is so powerful because life is in the blood. Life is in the blood. The blood of Jesus is the life of Jesus. When the blood drained and it finished, Jesus died. So he gave all his life for us. He released the blood. The blood was flowing and the last drop, Jesus died. So when you call the blood of Jesus, you are really calling the life of Jesus to that situation. When you call his name, you call him. And we answer us. So those are the weapons that we have for our warfare. I pray God will continue to help us. We have learned them. Let's go back and read over this thing. Where we can apply them to our life. I want us to guard our days and begin to pray to God. In any way, if you are still fighting a battle, you are just finished one, or maybe you did not win the last one, just pray and say, God, help me. To put on all this work. Help me, Lord. Let's pray to God and say, help me, Lord. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for your word. Thank you for the grace you have given unto us to be at your feet to learn from you today. We pray, oh God, every word we have received today, let them meet with faith. Let them meet with faith in our heart, oh God, that they may be for fruit. That our life shall be transformed. That any battle of life, any spiritual battle we shall engage in as from today, we shall not be defeated, we shall not be destroyed, we shall not be wounded, and we shall come out victorious. We bless you, Lord, because you are ever with us, and you are our captain, you are our commander. We shall keep on following you, we shall not go back from you. We thank you, Father, because you are always faithful. Thank you for your Jesus' precious name, we are praying.
Amen.